Call the board meeting to order. We'll stand and be led in the pledge by Ms. Prokosh.
Pledge allegiance.
United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of reflection. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Prokosh. May I roll call, please?
Mr. Howard?
Present.
Mr. Lawson? Levinsky?
Here.
Mr. Lewis?
Here.
Ms. McAfee?
Here.
Ms. Prokosh?
Here.
Ms. Reg?
Here.
Mr. Woodhull?
Here.
Here. Before we get started with the agenda, I just wanted to take this opportunity to read a statement that is currently posted on our district's website in regards to the rescheduling of the budget workshops. We are taking this opportunity to discuss the recently updated budget workshop schedule. It's come to the attention of the district that the state's budget will be enacted on Friday, March 22nd. There is a potential that our district will be receiving additional funding from the state in the final state budget, and this information could potentially change the outcome of our projected 2013-2014 district budget. This information, coupled with the fact that we have received no new information since the last budget workshop held on February 21st at the NFA main campus, led us to the decision to revisit our budget workshop schedule. The next budget workshop will be on April the 4th at Meadow Hill from 6 to 8 p.m. This will allow the board to make informed decisions about the budget and with the most updated and accurate information. As with the previous budget workshops, the last half hour will be reserved for the public comment to take input from the public on suggestions on how to address the 2013-14 budget gap. In addition, the board will be holding a special meeting to allow for public comment on the 2013-2014 budget on April 9th, also to be held at Meadow Hill at 6 p.m. The public comment portion will be for a period of 1 hour. We are doing that because after we have our final budget workshop, there wasn't going to be a board meeting, and we wanted the community to be able to have an opportunity for one last time to give input on the budget that was being proposed for adoption. If you'd like to participate in public comment, it will be on a first-come, first-served basis by contacting the district clerk. And after receiving the public comments on April the 9th, the board will have a special meeting on April 10th at Meadow Hill at 6 p.m. for the purpose of adopting the 2013-2014 district budget. I hope that clears up any misinformation that might be out there about why the meetings were rescheduled. Next item on the agenda is a report from the superintendent.
Thank you, Madam President. Tonight we will be listening to a presentation by Mrs. Aileen Toback, a seventh grade science teacher at Heritage Middle School. Mrs. Toback is also the young lady who runs our science fair every year to such a success. Ms. Toback will tell us about the Get Wet program. I would like to invite Mrs. Toback to join us at the podium or at the microphone. And with your three all-star students, or four all-star students. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pizzo. Good evening, everybody. Like you said, my name is Aileen Toback. I'm a science teacher at Heritage Middle School. I've been there 15 years. And I'm here to talk to you about a phenomenal program that we got involved with called Get Wet. So much of what we do in our science curriculum in middle school is trying to give our students a real-world experience, showing them that the skills that they're learning in the classroom are applicable outside, that what they're learning is valuable and has importance. The program of Get Wet offers just that. Started a long time ago, this gentleman up here is Pete Seeger. I'm sure everyone's heard him. Did a lot of work with trying to maintain and clean up the Hudson River. Since then, a lot of work has been done by the EPA, and now reaching out to middle school and high school students to help monitor groundwater in our area. Many of us in the area have well water. I know myself, I also have well water. And what we don't realize is that there is no monitoring by the government of that water. So if you drink well water, nobody's going around and testing that. There's no funding for that. That's where Get Wet comes in. Get Wet was started by a professor in Maine who wanted to find that data, wanted to know what the quality of our water was up in Maine, also now in New York and a few other states. And in order to do that with the lack of funding, she came up with a great idea of enlisting students to do the research for her. So what we've done is partnered with Mr. Helbig and the Water Conservancy. Students brought in water samples, well water samples, water from their taps as well. Their girls are here to share with you some of the tests that they've done. And to test it, to find out what's the quality of our drinking water in this area. The good news is that we have phenomenal drinking water, tap water and well water alike. That data has been uploaded to a site in New York State. The data that my students generated is now going to be used by researchers all over the United States. And it's become part of a running database, the second year in a row that we're doing it, that these students have generated the data that's going to be so important to monitor water quality in the area. No, we won't make them sing tonight.
Well, in the middle school classroom, this is the point at which I make them sing.
Let you speak to Mr. Helbig. He's the one, our contact and our educator that comes in and helps work with the students. Mr. Helbig.
Well, let me give you a brief run-through of what the students discovered when they did this test. We had 62 student participants, and when you generate data, each of the students did six tests on their own home water. Those tests were for nitrate, which is possibly an indication of sewer infiltration into water. They was tested for chloride, which is for salt in the water, for hardness, for pH, for a number of other variables. And they generated data. And what I like to show the students first is that that data is pretty much incomprehensible. If you just put it in a spreadsheet like that, nobody can really, no more than a great musician can look at a score and understand what it sounds like. In order to make sense of the data, you have to put it in different form. Here's a graph of that same data, or actually one column of that data. That's the chloride pencil. Look at that. That's like my report. In any case, what that shows is all of the student tests for salt. Now, where does salt come from in water? It comes from mostly road salt in this neck of the woods. And so what we found was that all of the tests were well below that red line of 250 milligrams per liter. So all of those tests were safe in a good range, no problem at all. Except every single one of them had a little bit of salt in it, which shows you a little bit of how our water is affected by how we treat our roads every day. So we continued to go through, we did a whole bunch of data, and we took that data, we turned it into maps that shows where the various data points were collected. We did nitrate, we did pH, we did hardness, we did conductivity. Oh, okay, so great. So, and then we did some statistics with them.
I'm just going to have some of the, these are some of my junior scientists, some of the young ladies that actually did the test. They'll explain to you a little bit about what we tested for our water in this area. Lily Tejada. Yeah.
Okay, the pH test is the test of how acidic or basic the water is. pH is too high or too low, can damage the pipes and make lead leak into the water, which is
And pH was in the normal range, which was great. Abby McMillan?
The hardness test can determine if the water had a hard condition. Hardness in the water leaves the skin dry and can deposit on shiny surfaces and builds up over time in appliances. Hard water contains minerals such as magnesium and calcium with a charge.
We did find some level of hardness among the well water samples. If you have well water and you get that yellow ring, it's either in the toilet or the sink. Generally, that's what it's from. Amanda Cotton.
Conductivity is a measure of the ability of water to pass an electrical current. Conductivity in water is affected by the presence of metals, such as the magnesium, calcium, iron, and aluminum.
No dangerous levels of metals were found in the water, which is great. And Brianna Delgado.
We also tested on nitrate, which is found in many types of food. But if there's high levels of nitrate, people can get sick. Nitrate is from animal waste, private septic systems, wastewater, flooded sewers, and polluted storm water runoff. Also plant nitrate.
That was one of the ones that we were a little bit worried about to see the results of, no nitrate, which were really great. That was excellent. And the students really did, they had a great time doing this. It lasted 2 days, and then Mr. Helbig was kind enough to come back and share all those results with us, which again, are generated and on the New York State website. So it was a great opportunity for them. And something that we're certainly, looking to continue this partnership in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Toback, and your all-star students, and thanks again for all that hard work at the Science Fair every year. We really appreciate it.
And thank you for taking the time to come and share with us and the rest of the community one of many wonderful things that's going on in our school district.
Next, it gives me great pleasure to announce that we have tonight with us Steve Gold, who is the Chief of Staff of Frank Scartato's Assemblyman's staff, and he's here to share some of the latest things that are going on in Albany with the between the Assembly and the Senate, and hopefully there's going to be more money for us. But I want to publicly thank you, Mr. Gold and Mr. Scartatos, for the $250,000 that you gave to us last year that saved many jobs in our district. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much. The Assemblyman is sorry that he's not here. He's actually on his way back from Albany. This whole month has actually been budget month in Albany, and they've had long nights, and I have a good report for the board and for the district regarding school state aid. That is just fresh new information that he told me about an hour ago. And that is that the way the process works is that the governor presents a budget. And in Albany, there are two houses. There's the Senate and there's the Assembly. And for most of you, Senator Larkin is your senator and Assemblyman Frank Scartatos is your assemblyman. And what happens is that the budget is presented by the governor, and then the two houses each produce their own version of a budget. And then they get together and they compromise. And this week has been the week of compromise. Today is when they compromised on school state aid. And I am happy to report that it appears as if there was going to be $290 million more, not for Newburgh, but for the state.
You got me excited there for a minute.
Sorry, wish it could be that. So you're absolutely right in waiting. We don't know yet how that's going to be broken down, and that should come out by Friday. We expect that the assemblyman will be working until late Thursday night, early Friday. Probably at 2 or 3 in the morning is when they'll come to the full agreement on the budget and vote on it. But it should contain an additional $290 million in aid, school aid. The assembly did, in their version of it, an $834 million increase. And in working with the governor and with the Senate, it was moved to $290 million. The assemblyman wanted me to say that he will be working very hard this year also to try to get some additional aid, as he did, as was mentioned by the superintendent. Last year, he was able to get $250,000 for Newburgh. The other things that I want to mention is that the assembly budget also rejected the executive's plan, which was the governor's plan, to freeze expense-based aids to school districts, and instead utilizes the most current data and redirects an additional $208 million into the foundation aid formula to ensure the neediest schools get that aid. The proposal also restores $100 million to gap elimination adjustments, GEA, and includes proposed changes to the educational formula to take into account current population trends in order to ensure that the schools receive their fair share. Pre-K education has been a priority for Assemblyman Skartatos. The Assembly's budget preserves the full $25 million in pre-K grant and modifies the grant to authorize new half-day and full-day slots. And the Assemblyman states that investing in pre-K will provide children with the head start they need to be successful in school and in life. Just lastly, Assemblyman Skartatos really does care about Newburgh and the Newburgh School District to his core. He wants you to know that he'll be willing and will help in any way that you ask of him. We have a district office located on North Plank Road, and you're all invited to come and stop by and speak to us. If the assemblyman is there, he'll speak to you, or you can make an appointment to speak to him. And we want to say that we know that you're under a very difficult situation right now. You're not alone. The assemblyman has in his district other school districts that have a $10 million budget gap. So you are not alone, but we know how hard it is to resolve that issue. And he just wants to offer his help in any way that he can. Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, Mr. Gold. We appreciate it very much. Thank you. That ends this section of my presentation tonight, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Pizzo. Be it resolved that the Board of Education hereby suspends bylaw number 0167.2E, which allows 5 minutes per speaker during public participation. And for tonight's meeting, the time limit will be 3 minutes per speaker. Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call.
Mr. Howard? Yes. Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAtee?
Yes.
Ms. Botosh?
Yes.
Ms. Redd?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucek?
Yes. I'll take this time to review some of our public comment procedures. We do allow a half hour for public comment on agenda items, the beginning portion of the meeting, and subsequently a half hour for non-agenda items for public comment. If, as has happened in the past, there are no comments during the agenda items this evening, I will add that the board will add that half hour onto the half hour at the end to allow a full hour at the end for all comments on non-agenda items. Comments shall be limited this evening to 3 minutes per in duration per speaker, whether speaking individually or on behalf of an organization. All statements shall be directed to the board. No participant may address or question board members or administrators individually. Speakers may comment on matters of public interest involving school operations and programs, but may not criticize or personally attack any person connected with the school district. And issues concerning specific employees, either by name or by identifying reference, will not be tolerated, and any violation of this will result in the speaker being asked to sit down. So if you have any comments on agenda items at this time, please step to one of the microphones and give your name and address. Being none, we will add that half hour on till the end of our evening this evening. And Mr. McCoy, the board clerk, has been collecting over the past several weeks people that have been calling in on a first-come, first-served basis, and I will take them first in order that they were received, and if there is time available at the end, after all of those people have been heard, then anyone else that is in the audience that would like to make a public comment, time allows, you will have the opportunity at that time. Next item on the agenda is from the board president. I have a resolution to approve the revision of the school and library budget vote, election calendar, and polling places for the May 21st, 2013 vote. Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Hall?
Yes.
Yes. Our next item is from the superintendent.
We have no items in this section.
Thank you, Mr. Pizzo. Next item on the agenda is from the assistant superintendent for student intervention and support services.
Thank you, Madam President. I have one item for your consideration right now for resolution to arrange for the placement of students with disabilities as recommended by the district's committee on preschool special education and the district's committee on special education. In order to authorize to approve the authorization of funds in order to implement special education programs and services consistent with such recommendation.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Good.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucheco?
Yes.
Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mrs. Rumley. Our next item on the agenda is from the Executive Director of Curriculum and Instruction.
Thank you, Madam President. I'd like to request to add item M to the agenda.
Can I have a motion to add item M to the
agenda? So moved.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucheco?
Yes.
Item A is a resolution to authorize the superintendent of schools to execute an agreement with the Boys and Girls Club of Newburgh at the Glen Hines Center. The funding source is the School Innovation Fund.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucheco?
Yes.
Item B is a resolution to authorize the superintendent of schools to execute an agreement with Dr. D. Berlinghoff to provide professional development at Temple Hill Academy. The funding source is the School Innovation Fund.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucheco?
Yes.
Item C is a resolution to authorize the superintendent of schools to execute an agreement with Dr. Joan Miller to provide professional development at Temple Hill Academy.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Lucheco?
Yes.
Item D is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Albany, New York for the State Wrestling Championships, February 21st to 23rd, 2013. The funding source is Athletics General Fund.
Motion.
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item E is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Webster, New York for the state swimming championships, February 28th through March 2nd, 2013. The funding source is Athletics General Fund.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item F is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Ithaca, New York for the state track meet, March 1st to 2nd, 2013. The funding source is Athletics General Fund.
We have a motion. Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item G is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Cornwall, New York for the NFA students, May 1st to 3rd. The funding source is the Sherpa Club and General Fund.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item H is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Orlando, Florida for the AmeriCheer National Cheerleading Championship, March 14th through 19th. The funding source is Athletics General Fund.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch? Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item I is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Armonk, New York for the New York Math League competition, April 12th to 13th, 2013. The funding source is Management Efficiency Grant.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item J is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Cornwall, New York for NFA students, May 10th through 11th, 2013. The funding source is Black Rock Forest.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Yes.
Item K is a resolution to approve the NFA Junior ROTC drill team's participation in the Summer Leadership Camp in Cornwall, New York, June 28th through July 3rd, 2013. The funding source is Junior ROTC student activity budget.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item L is a resolution to approve an overnight field trip to Paterson, New York for the Fostertown Science Club, June 12th through 14th, 2013. The funding source is Science Club PTC.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Law. Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Krupczyk?
Yes.
Item M is a resolution to authorize the Superintendent of Schools, Board President, and Director of Career Readiness to execute an articulation agreement with Bryan and Stratton College.
May I have a motion? Questions or comments? Yes, Mr. Lawson.
So, this just came on.
Correct.
Okay, so will the kids receive college credit for that?
Yes.
Dr. Shanahan?
I mean, transferable college credits, I should add.
College credit for that college.
So, so let me be direct. My concern is that a lot of the college credits that we used to give, kids used to give, they weren't able to be transferred to some universities. They weren't accepted. Will these credits be used?
These won't. This is just an articulation for the CTE program, special programs in CTE that align with the programs offered at this college. So the credits are only for this college. They're not transferable.
I know we've had discussions about identifying a school that would accept these credits and to be able to transfer credits, because I know some of them. I'm sorry?
And we have that. And this is just one articulation agreement. We have other articulation agreements where students can get college credit that are transferable to other universities, but just not, this is not one of them.
Yeah, I guess my concern is, though, that most colleges, most of the kids that got these credits were not able to transfer them to colleges of their choice. And so that's my concern. And I wanted to find out if we're having, because we did have discussions about identifying a school where the kids would earn college credits that would be able to transfer to all universities.
Mm-hmm. Outside of the SUNY system, really,
right,
is what you're referring
right
to.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So, I have a problem with this, but I just wanted to make sure that we were moving in the direction where those other college credits will also be available.
From the other articulation agreements? Absolutely. We have that. Mercy College, for example.
Yeah, but the Mercy College credits, they're not being... So Mercy College won't transfer to NYU?
Well, that's between them. Between Mercy and the other colleges.
Right, but what Mr. Lawson is asking is, are we outreaching to colleges whose credit to have our have courses that our children can earn credits that can be transferred to colleges like NYU?
Absolutely. That's that when we look to make an articulation agreement, that's one of the first things we look at. And in many cases, we have that, but in this case, that's not a part of this articulation agreement.
I get that. So this one, it's not a part of, right? The Mercy College, we recognize you can't transfer to certain colleges and universities.
Right, to certain colleges.
So we have one in place right now that is universal, that when you earn these college credits, they can be transferred to someplace else.
Not an articulation. It really depends if one university, if a university would accept Mercy College credits, then it's transferable. Some universities would not accept that. But we have, students can earn college credits through AP, through passing the AP exam, for example. Those are transferable to and applicable to many colleges.
So I think in response to my question, I would like to see us move in a direction to identify an articulation agreement that would allow students to earn college credits.
That are transferable to private colleges moving forward. And so when we're looking at these articulation agreements, to be specific as to where those credits will be transferable to outside of the SUNY system. Yes, Mrs. McAfee. Mrs. McAfee, can I just ask you to pull your mic in so that everybody can hear you? If you pull it closer, then we can hear you better.
I have concerns about this because of the facts, first of all, that we didn't really have a chance to absorb it and pass word of all that we would like. I'm not personally familiar with this college, and I have a secondary concern that perhaps we're letting our students be used, that they are being encouraged to go to this college. Because when I'm looking at it, I'm trying to figure out what's the gain for the kids. I don't necessarily see it. It's probably there, but I don't see it right now. But I see the gain for the college, because the college is trying to entice these kids then to come to their school, right? Isn't that a fair statement then?
Yes, absolutely. But there is a gain for our students too. Through the articulation, through the alignment of the courses that we teach and the courses offered at this college, by fulfilling the requirements of our courses, the students they can get 3 free credits at this college, which gives them a leg up through high school work. They're already starting to earn college credits. But it's true, it is limited to this college.
Madam President.
Yes, Mr. Howard.
In light of the questions that we have, a few members that do have problems, is it possible that we can table this? Is this under a timeline? Do we have time constraints with regards to addressing this evening?
Dr. Shanahan?
We can table it.
Would you entertain a motion?
Can I have a motion to table Resolution M?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis? McAfee?
Yes.
Brokaw?
Yes.
Mr. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodall?
Yes.
Yes.
And that concludes my items.
Thank you, Dr. Shanahan. Our next item, yes.
Could I further ask that it come to the curriculum committee? We have a meeting, in 2 weeks? And perhaps that would give Dr. Shanahan time to prepare what should be gone over, and any of the other board members who are not members of the committee could perhaps join us that day. It would be the first Tuesday in April.
Is that agreeable to you as well, Dr. Shanahan? Okay. So this item will go to the curriculum committee on April 4th. Okay.
First Tuesday, April 2nd.
That's what I thought, Mr. Howard. April 2nd, 4 o'clock, Superintendent's Conference Room, 124 Grand Street. And next item on the agenda is from the Assistant Superintendent for Business.
Thank you, Madam President. First item is a resolution to authorize payment of property tax refunds pursuant to court orders. There are 4 of them. First one is the Mid Valley Mall. That amount is $602,044.78. Second one is the Newburgh Mall. That amount is $1,139,500.30. Third one is for an A&A Food Systems doing business as Perkins Restaurant Bakery. That is for $7,070.83. And the fourth one is for Colville Limited Liability Corp., also in the town of Newburgh, $5,806.
Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodall?
Yes.
Yes.
Item B is a resolution to transfer funds, $1.7 million from the tax authority reserve to general fund.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch? Mr. Woodall?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Item C is a resolution to transfer funds, $969,738, from the capital fund to the debt service fund.
Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodall?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Item D is a resolution to accept the monthly bills and reports.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodall?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Pacella. Next item on the agenda is for the Assistant Superintendent for Human Resources.
Thank you, Madam President. On the human resources agenda, items A through G, we have on the professional side, home teacher appointments, return from leave of absence, change of location, and on the civil service side, we have appointments, change of status, leave of absence, retirements, and an employee who passed away.
I have a motion. Questions or comments? Yes, Mr. Lewis.
I would like item A separated from the list.
Can I have a roll call on item B? Well, A through G.
Minus A.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lofton?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Wilcox?
Yes.
Ms. Res? Mr. Wilcox?
Yes.
Ms. Bouchette?
Yes. Now, can I have a roll call on resolution A, please?
Mr. Howard?
No.
Mr. Lawson?
No.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
No.
Ms. McAfee?
No.
Ms. Trollcock?
No.
Ms. Resch? Mr. Woodhull?
No.
Ms. Bouchette?
No. Let me make a statement of clarification. I believe the reason for this is because we have another program possibly going into place in lieu of home teaching. Is that what the objection is? Okay. Yes, Ms. Resch.
Right.
They should go to this program as soon as possible tomorrow.
You're a word you said.
So, okay. So the statement from Mr. Lewis was he's been consistent with his voting no on the approval of home teaching appointments because he does not support home teaching as a way to deliver instruction to a particular group of students. So we have been working diligently as a board to put an alternative solution in place around this particular item. So Mr. McLemore, is there an update as to when this will be implemented? I know that there was a consensus taken that it would be done as soon as possible. Do we have any idea when the majority of the students that are currently on home teaching will be going to an alternative location to receive instruction? So, and so the only other question I have then, Mrs. Limer, is if this does not get approved this evening, as it has not, do we have enough home teachers in place between now and April 1st before this program begins?
I believe we do.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Levinstein.
Couple of things. Approving these home teachers does not give them the work. It just makes them certified to do the work and we approve it. So what I'm saying is if they're approved at any point, doesn't mean that they're sent out to
they're necessarily working.
It gives us the authority to pay them if we needed them to provide home teaching services, not only to kids that may be suspended, but to kids that are on medical home teaching, that type of thing.
That was my second part, but you're saying, I'm sure we have plenty of home teachers available if they're needed. So I mean, just by approving these to be home teachers doesn't give them a job or make another student need home teacher. It's one more available from the top.
Yes.
Any other questions on this item?
Okay,
thank you.
Resolution H is the resolution for the professional change of status.
Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Yes, Mr. Lewis.
I'm still being consistent. I'm just saying to vote yes on this item because we are hiring teachers off of the sublist item, I assume. And I don't think it's proper because I think we are neglecting to hire minority teachers from that list.
Mrs. Limer, where do the hires from this list come from?
Numbers one and number two, we advertised for these positions. These individuals applied. They had worked in the capacity of per diem subs. So to answer your question, they came off the sub list. And number three is a recall from the teaching, laid off teaching assistants.
Thank you. Other questions or comments on this item? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
No.
Mrs. Lawson?
No.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mrs. Lewis?
No.
Ms. McAfee?
No.
Roll call. Ms. Rash? Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes.
Resolution I is a resolution to rescind an original Schedule J appointment and make another appointment for a coaching appointment.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Resolution J is to abolish a full-time account clerk position and create a full-time senior account clerk position. No effect on the general fund.
Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes. Resolution K is to approve a change of status of a civil service employee.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes.
Resolution L is to approve the release and settlement agreement for case number 11-CV-4575.
Can I have a motion? Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes.
Resolution M is to approve a tenure recommendation for a teacher.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes.
And Madam President, there'll be additional items forward for your approval after discussion in executive session.
Thank you, Mrs. Limer. Our next item on the agenda is from the Clerk of the Board.
Thank you, Madam President. I'm asking for the approval of minutes of the special meeting on February 7th, special meeting on February 12th, and regular meeting on February 26th, 2013.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
Yes.
Ms. Rash?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. McCoy. At this time, we will have public discussion and comment on non-agenda items. We have a list. First, we will hear from Ms. Billy Kubik.
Hi. I'm Billy. I have David and our youngest daughter, Jessica, and we're from Montgomery Street in Newburgh. Tonight, we and other members of the community would like to tell you about some of the many outstanding qualities of Bryan from Necsd Elementary School.
Hold on a second. We're trying to up the mic so we can hear you.
Gonna need a new time.
We'll start with the clock over.
I can put on my teacher's voice if we need.
Go ahead.
Okay. We're from Montgomery Street. We're here with other members of the community to tell you about some of the outstanding qualities of Rising Sun and Hudson Elementary and its unique role in the enlarged city school district. Before we get started, I just want to say a quick thank you to everyone who has shown such tireless dedication to preserving this valuable institution for our children and protecting the right of equitable access to educational opportunities for future generations. This is our family story. Jessie spent first and second grade needing me to come scrape her off the sidewalk and force her into the building when she refused to even enter the school. She cried and screamed from 6 a.m. well into the night, every single day, how she hated school, hated learning, hated herself. We cried, begged, and sought help from every avenue in and out of the school system. I pulled my hair out in frustration, that's a lot, when two sick days saw her coming home with over 30 dittos in first grade. Sandwiched in that stack was a note from the school that they were experiencing a paper shortage and requesting donations. In second grade, her teacher assigned the students numbers to use instead of their names that went on everything from books to cubbies, so it's easier to switch kids out as they come and go. That teacher also thought it was productive to have the entire class pressure my child in unison to hurry up and finish her assignment, or they would all lose playtime. Sadly, this happened right here at another school in the district. Finally, in the fall of 2012, we were able to switch her to Horizons. Like many others, I thought IB was some random motto from the magnet district or some aspect of the accelerated program that would have nothing to do with us. I could not have been wrong. While education has morphed into a content memorization machine with the goal of raising test scores instead of students, IB actually teaches students how to learn. You know the saying, give a man a fish and he eats for a day, teach him to fish and he eats for a lifetime.
Go ahead.
In our context, that translates to give a student the facts and they know them for that test, teach them to seek knowledge and they'll learn for a lifetime. At Horizons, we found offices with open doors, engaged students, visionary educators, involved families, and a surrounding community rich in history and culture that has embraced the students of Newburgh for the past 217 years. And we found our daughter. Jessie still fights the anxiety she developed in the other school and struggles not to shut down completely at time pressure of any kind, like me. She works harder for 80s than most A students ever do, and we're more proud of that work than any perfect score could ever make us. She now hungers for knowledge, asks endless questions, and if she doesn't like the answer, she does her own research and either proudly proves you wrong or tells you how you should have explained it in the first place. She strives to be a better person. How many nine-year-olds even know what that means?
Oh, sorry.
Step into Horizons, you'll find every student does.
And please feel free to turn in what you have written there, Dr. Shanahan. Thank you very much. Ms. Angelina Guzman.
I am 6 years old. I am in Ms. Catalano's class, second grade at Horizons. I think we need to keep Horizons on the Hudson open because 530 children will not get the IB education that we can only get at Horizons. We learn a lot at Horizons. My favorite subject is geometry. The best IB profiles that describe me are inquirer, because I like to ask questions and wonder about things, knowledgeable, because I always want to know more and share my knowledge, communicator and risk taker, because I took a risk to speak up and say a speech here, and caring, especially caring, because caring means having the courage to stand up what you think is right, and that's keeping the school going. Thank you for letting kids continue to have a good education at Horizon. And I brought a message from some of my friends who can't be here. Help save HOH. We love our school. We don't want to be separated. We are friends. We stick together. We learn a lot here. This is the only school that I would like for second out of fifth grade. Save Horizon. We love our school. We don't want to be apart. We have a lot of fun. Heal our heart. HOH equals heal our heart. Do not rip us apart. Help save our school. HOH is important to us. Thank you.
Ms. Robin, who is one?
I'm her proud mama, and I'm proud.
You should be proud.
Yes. And I'm proud parent as well. I wanted to give a little background about our students. 83% are racial minorities. 80% of our students are considered educationally disadvantaged based on their poverty status. So compared to the district, our African-American student population is actually double the district's average. And we have 20% more students from poverty compared to the district's average. Many students live in the city, and many are so close that they walk to school. I am concerned about the comments that have been made that suggest that students should be relieved to get out of the city of Newburgh. It's not about diluting our students, their culture, or their life experience. It's about meeting them where they are, drawing on their life experience, building upon their strengths, and developing their weaknesses. Our demographics make us more aware and sensitive to their circumstances. Our school is most prepared to succeed and be a district leader in closing the achievement gap and getting all of our students college and career ready through IB. Would these students, our student population, be experiencing the same academic progress and priority elsewhere? Changing a school culture is not something that you can get on the cheap. It's not about making photocopies of IB units and handing them out throughout the district. Our IB program is not transferable to another school. Authorization is rigorous and must be earned. It requires commitment, hard work, and school community buy-in. The investment has been made in an internationally acclaimed program that is proven at transforming inner city schools into thriving learning institutions and recognized as such as both the Bush and Obama administrations. Horizons is realizing the promise of the IB program. This progress will be stamped out, and the investments as well as taxpayer funds squandered if Horizons is closed 6 years into the process after only 2 years as an authorized IB school. As you've heard, Horizons fosters a genuine love of learning that our students will carry with them for life. Please come and see for yourself. We are succeeding with the most disadvantaged of our district's students. We are closing the achievement gap. We are giving every single one of our students a world-class education through IB. Do not count us out. Please do not bet against us. We do not want to see any of our schools closed, but we will not let our school be closed. We look forward to your support, and we'll be voting on May 21st. Yes. We would also like to thank Assemblyman Scartados and his Chief of Staff, Steve Gold, for coming. Thank you.
Ms. J.
Jerry Maldonado.
My name is Jerry Maldonado, and I'm a proud parent of a student at Horizons and a homeowner on Montgomery Street in the city of Newburgh. My wife and I moved to the city of Newburgh about 7 years ago, right before the birth of our daughter. And it's no exaggeration for me to say that we decided to make Newburgh our home, despite the many challenges the city faces, in large part because of the city's diversity and the exceptional educational program offered at Horizons. Unfortunately, now the Board of Education is threatening to dismantle one of the few assets that continues to attract families and homeowners like us to the city of Newburgh, its community-based school. Indeed, over the past 2 decades, the Board of Education has systematically dismantled many of the schools located within the city of Newburgh. In fact, 5 out of 6, or over 80% of recent school closures, have been located within the city's boundaries. Whether intentional or not, it's important to point out that the systematic closure of schools located in the city has profound racial justice implications and disproportionately impacts working families and Latino and African American households that live in those surrounding communities. It also discourages new families from moving back to the city and perpetuates a vicious cycle of residential and economic segregation that hurts the entire city and the region. Over the last few decades, the closure of schools within the city's boundaries has also taken a toll on many of our neighborhoods. Just take a look at the condition of the Liberty Street School, which the Board of Education closed a few decades ago. Today, that building is abandoned and nearly collapsing, a symbol of urban blight and despair, sitting in the midst of a hollowed-out neighborhood. Make no mistake about it, that is what happens to urban neighborhoods when you systematically close and dismantle our community school. So we're all here as parents and concerned community members to advise you that this kind of behavior is no longer acceptable. No mas.
No mas.
We will not continue to sit idly by while you gut the city's educational programs and shutter our schools. We will not allow you to balance your books on the backs of our children and our neighborhoods. And while we regret the closure of any school in the region, and we prefer that none close, this debate is much more than just about budget constraints and enrollment numbers. It's about fairness and equity, and ensuring that the people of the city of Newburgh do not continue to bear the disproportionate burden of educational cuts and school closures. So we're here to request that you refrain from closing yet another school within the city of Newburgh that could be perceived as having a discriminatory impact on our communities. We are prepared to take any and all actions necessary for ensuring that the civil rights of our families are protected. And we look forward to working with the faculty and administration at Horizons to ensure that the city's future, our children, receive the best public education possible so that we can get back to the urgent business of building a better future together. Thank you.
Mr. Darren Stradire.
When I heard that the board was considering closing Horizons, I was concerned. I went through the budget line by line and I found $8 million in cuts for this year alone, and I sent that to the board's attention. If anybody wants a copy of that, I have it. We need to cut $100,000 from this year's video surveillance equipment. We've spent $500,000 in the last 5 years on video surveillance equipment, and I know we don't have a prison in our district. You spend $215,000 a year on sports-related school busing. If we take that amount and we buy 7 new passenger vans and have the coaches drive the students to the games, we can save $860,000 in the next 5 years. We spend $420,000 on leasing copier equipment, renting. That's $4,200 per copy of renting per year. I can look at it two ways. Either the district is getting ripped off, or I should have been a copier salesman.
Mr. Stradine, can I just ask you to face the board since you're supposed to be addressing
sure.
us?
Sure.
Thank you.
Cut district salaries by 5% and central by 5%.
Yes.
And if anybody in the district has a vehicle that is paid for by the district, return the keys to the board and let them drive to work like all of us have. Occupational education program. We spend so much money on that program, but we can make it a community-based internship program where business leaders in this community can hire our students and train them in real-world conditions. And at the end, when they graduate, they can be hired by those same businesses and they can be hired right here and work in Newburgh. That's $36 million in 5 years just from those few items that we can save in 5 years. Parents, isn't it sad that we have to come here and beg for our child's education to this board? District and board members, stop relying only on the district for their support and ideas for the budget. You have hundreds of people here. Each one of them has one idea at least to save money for the district. This is our district. We are the Newburgh School District. You need to listen to us. No mas, that's true. Now, we will be watching how you vote over the next few weeks. And whether it's this year, next year, or the year after, whether you're running for the board, we will remember how you vote. And we will all be voting on May 21st. Thank you.
Let you know that the entire board did receive your suggestions, as well as Mr. Pacella, the assistant superintendent for business, and he will speak to some of the items in a moment. And I'd also like to say that we have encouraged the public input and for us to look outside of the people sitting around this table for recommendations. We've been accepting that at our budget workshop meetings. We will continue to do so, as well as accepting recommendations that come through the district's website, and all of them are received and are seen by all of the board members and are reviewed. Mr. Pacella.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Iron. I apologize if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly. I did look over all of your items. I didn't answer all of them, just for the sake of time. Certainly you can make an appointment and come see me and I'll address most of them. But most of these items that you propose at this $8 million, they are proposed cuts, they're not found cuts. Deal with contractual issues that are mutually negotiated between the board and the three unions within the district. You just can't arbitrarily broad stroke paint a reduction. The OCED program, we've reviewed this over the years. We are a non-component of BOCES. So I'm sure that the plight of some of these children want to go and continue on a career tech ed, and we have to do that through an accredited program that's all sanctioned by New York State Education Department. We have requested reductions in transportation costs. The idea of vans, we did implement one. However, we cannot bind our teachers to drive. Again, that would have to be something that's negotiated, nor do we have contractual obligations for union members to drive or to fix those vans, but we are looking at them. No, this is not gonna be a debate back and forth. Please make an appointment and I'll certainly address it to you. But a lot of the other items that you've looked at, we have gone through this over the past few years, but a lot of them deal with competitive bid pricing because we're such a large district. You brought up the copy releases. This has been competitively bid over the past few years. We can't go out and just solicit low-cost operations. And some of our machines are not the run-of-the-mill desktop printers. Certainly you heard tonight that dittos are handed out. We do have 13,000 students throughout the district. We educate 11,000 of them. So certainly you know the toll that photocopiers take on a daily basis. We look to streamline this. We have a central printing location. And we encourage all teachers when they want to have educational materials photocopied that they email us through the technology piece, email the printing department, so that the printing department can do this on our really high-end machines. So again, I have looked at every one of your line items. I have discussed this with the board at length. I have looked at possible ways it can be produced, and if we have to, we'll address them again. But please make an appointment to come see me, and I'd be happy to talk to you.
Ms. Teresa Brown.
I swear I did not, this is all written here first. Dear Board of Education members, parents, teachers, students, and community members, my name is Teresa Brown, and I have the honor of serving as an employee of the Newburgh and Large City School District, as well as being a taxpayer within the district and a parent of a student who attended elementary school in the district. From these lenses, I asked to address the Board of Education to provide what I believe is some much-needed feedback at a time when budgetary challenges weigh heavily on our district. Much of the deficits being experienced by school districts is caused by variables outside of their control. Unfunded mandates, increases in insurance costs, the tax cap, retirement contributions, etc., are all adding to the increased cost of educating our students. What is within our control is the manner by which we choose to close the gap. With that in mind, the Newburgh and Large City School District has taken steps to engage all stakeholders in finding a solution to the budget crunch. The district has established a budget information link on their webpage, a public suggestion section for members of the community to express their ideas for reducing the deficit, and is once again conducting budget meetings where community members can hear firsthand the issues being discussed, as well as provide constructive feedback to the board. I believe we are one of only a few districts making this level of effort to involve everyone in the problem-solving process, employees, taxpayers, and students. As a district employee, there is always the possibility that I will no longer be employed because my position is not mandated. Additionally, as an employee, I've had to engage in very difficult conversations with colleagues regarding possible program cuts, with full knowledge that it could lead to the layoffs of some of the best educators I've had the privilege of working with. As a taxpayer, I can say that I am willing and able to pay the additional costs to continue providing quality education to our students. However, I also know that while I can support that statement, there are members of our district that cannot afford a large tax increase. As a parent of a student who went through grades K through 5 within the district, I can say that she is now a 21-year-old scholar-athlete finishing her junior year at Division I college, who continually attributes her success to learning experiences she had within our district. We afforded her experiences beyond that of the mandated. We afforded her top-notch educators willing to assess her abilities and challenge her to develop her strengths and weaknesses. We offered her the opportunities to become a contributing member of society. To this day, she returns to Newburgh to volunteer at various community events. Considering all of this, I believe it is very important for the following to be said publicly. I understand that we are in a precarious situation. I do not believe any board or cabinet member wants to consider, let alone make the decision to reduce staff, close a school, or reduce the student support necessary to make our schools successful. I appreciate the difficult conversations being had and the outside-the-box thinking. I might not agree with everyone, but I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you for your service as the Board of Education, and I look forward to the continued collaboration of all of us to do what's best for our students.
Thank you, Mrs. Brown. Ms. Carol Lopez. Thank you for having me. I also am not in favor of having to close any school, and I also don't envy your position by any means. I would like to speak, however, to the various positive findings in support of the IB program, and specifically why it is such an important and vital program at Horizon and in the Newburgh District. Being on the state focus list, it doesn't make much sense to close an IB school, especially when IB is instrumental in turning around academically and economically disadvantaged schools. Taken from Martin Reeves, the president of the Association for Science Education, the professional organization supporting science in the UK, he states, while taking on challenges of the 21st century, it will require that we use best science, with the generation encouraged to develop an understanding of the subject through schooling. In order to achieve this goal, he'd like to see the curriculum be something more like that of the International Baccalaureate. Many students, therefore, have not been exposed to enough transdisciplinary learning or across the curriculum. They equally need a knowledge of math and other subjects. Not having that has required remedial courses be put into place. Cross-disciplinary learning can combat this, which is integral to the IB. This reminds me of what Mr. Antonelli had presented last week at the workshop. Children learn across disciplines, and they intermingle
subjects naturally, often without even realizing they're doing it. This is proof of learning how to learn and how to gain the use of that knowledge. Karen Purcell, Development Director at Marymount International School, supports the IB and shares that analysis conducted by the Higher Education Statistics Agency shows IB students are more qualified and successful at higher education institutions. She states, if we want to prepare the next generation for work in a globalized world, the breadth of subjects and languages, the emphasis on cultural diversity, and the self-management and independent learning that is encouraged by the IB provide the perfect foundation for future success. The Japanese government has actually approached the International Baccalaureate Organization to establish a system and a framework in which to teach their new generation. Eventually, this is to help their workforce work better cross-culturally, which they are finding is currently hard for them to do. Government panels are proposing increasing IB-certified schools in Japan to enhance the communication abilities of the Japanese students through greater knowledge and understanding of different cultures. One of the reasons for increased standards in the U.S. is to help us compete globally. Here we see other nations looking to incorporate the IB program. Getting rid of this program in our school completely goes against the global equalization we are trying to create within our students, especially if other nations want what we have at Horizon, right here in the city of Newburgh. Support is also stateside. Arkansas funds IB exams, Minnesota as well. Some states exempt IB students. We look forward to voting on May 21st and for your support. Thank you, Ms. Lopez. Ms. Nora Femister?
Requested the time for Nora Femister and Naomi Femister, who is my daughter. So if we could let her speak first on the continuation of what she has to say.
Okay.
Thank you.
My name is Naomi Femister, I'm 10 years old, and I'm in 5th grade accelerated at Horizons on the Hudson. I'm also the Vice President of the National Elementary Honor Society. Before I came here, I went to a private school called Bishop Dunn, and although I loved all my friends, I became very bored. And I realized that something had to change, but I didn't want to have to skip a grade. So my parents and I began to search for a more suitable school. Finally, we found Horizons on the Hudson, and I came in 2nd grade. Automatically, I loved it. The teachers are great, and I've met some of my best friends here, too. Plus, the accelerated program is a great choice for students who think at a level above their grade. Horizons on the Hudson also features many clubs and groups that you can join, such as the National Elementary Honor Society, math team, chorus, and band. We are also an IB school, which helps us students not only think locally, but to think globally as well. As part of our IB units, we've gone on multiple field trips and even been able to communicate with students from around the world through video conferencing. We also make use of modern technology with our computer lab where students can come in, research, and do other activities on the computer. Here at Horizons, we learn to be leaders in the 21st century. We do everything we can to service the community with events such as food drives and blood drives. In conclusion, I'm going to graduate this year, and I want even the pre-Kers to do the same when it's their time and enjoy what I did in my years at Horizons. So I'd like to formally invite you to my school so you can see for yourselves what I'm talking about before you make your decision and take it all away. Thank you for listening to me, and have a good night.
Thank you very much, Ms. Femister. Very well done. Yes.
Okay. But how about the time?
You get another 3 minutes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. After all that has been said, I don't think I need the 3 minutes. But anyway, I just wanted to continue Naomi's story, and instead of saying it from the student point of view, saying it from the parent point of view. We moved 10 years ago when I was pregnant with Naomi to Newburgh. And the reason why we did it wasn't because we had family here or friends or relatives. We only loved the house that we found, spacious and beautiful and in a beautiful area far away from the city where we lived for so many years. We were told the public schools were great, and even though I was just pregnant with my first daughter, it was of interest to know that we would be able to use public school. Years later, through my neighbors, I got to understand what was the reality of public schools in Newburgh, and I was advised to take my daughter to private school. So I did, and I did to the school that I thought it was the best. For 2 years, my daughter was the best student of her class. She was tested because there was something strange. She was never happy, even though she had perfect social behavior and friends at school. That wasn't the issue. The issue was that she wasn't excited about what she was learning there. And so she was tested, and being in first grade, she was told that she had a seventh grade level. So what do we do? The school told us, unfortunately, we can skip a grade and have her study with kids that are 2 years older, which I never wanted for her, or we're pretty not the school for her. So what do I do? And fortunately, a neighbor knew Horizons on the Hudson in the accelerator program. Because I was so skeptical, she set up a meeting with Ms. Vaughn, the principal, so I would be forced to go and see for myself. I went, skeptical, thinking that I was gonna be there just for 15 minutes and leave and say thank you very much, but not for me. I spent the whole morning there, going from classroom to classroom, from kindergarten to sixth grade in the accelerated program. But not only the accelerated program, what really amazed me was the discipline, the respect with which kids were treated there, the atmosphere, the involvement of the teachers and the staff there, from the receptionist, from the custodian, from the bodyguard, everyone. It really impressed me. So then the year after bodyguard, or the door guard, English as a second language, excuse me. But anyway, the point then was that even with a lot of fear, I made the decision, we made the decision, and Naomi started on second grade in Horizon. Not my other time. Just to make the story short, and the reason why I'm telling you this story is not just to voice here my personal situation, it's just because I would like you to experience the same that I experienced when I went there for the first time. Naomi, the first day she went to Horizons and came back home, she came out of the bus jumping and saying that it had been the best day that she ever had at school. And I didn't understand how school could be so good in just one day. I just want you to go and experience it for yourself. I would like to second her invitation, and really, before you make your decision, it's not about numbers. It's about the kids, and it's also about the staff that has been trained for years to teach not just math or English or science. It's to teach the kids how to be good citizens.
Thank you, Mrs. Femister.
Thank you.
Horizons on the Hudson did come before the board last week at the workshop and do a presentation of their program there, as well as you should be aware that several of the people sitting up here on stage have been to Horizons to see firsthand the program as it operates on a daily basis on more than one occasion. So thank you. Ms. Michelle Ryder.
Evening. Obviously, we have many speakers here tonight who are advocating to keep Horizons on the Hudson open. Our advocacy for this school and the IB program in particular, however, extends far beyond the question of this year's budget. The IB program that has now been authorized at Horizons cannot be replicated. The authorization is not transferable, and any school seeking to become an IB school must go through the rigorous multi-year process that HOH has been through. Similarly, you cannot simply distribute the IB-trained teachers from HOH throughout the district and hope that they somehow train their colleagues in other district buildings by osmosis.
Anyone who has witnessed the rigorous training and unit development that these teachers and administrators have been through would know that. And for those of you on the stage who have not been in the building, we invite and strongly encourage you to please pay a visit to this school and to see IB in action. Most importantly, IB methods and units are used in every classroom for every child at Horizons. Contrary to some misconceptions, this is not a program that's been implemented just for the accelerated students. The four top performing high schools in New York all offer IB. This includes the Yonkers School District, which has very similar demographics to our school district. The investment that this district has made in the IB program at Horizons is now paying off, finally. 1 year after receiving our IB authorization, Horizons' Terra Nova scores are beginning to rival those of the traditionally higher performing schools in the district in several categories. This progress is measurable. We are looking forward at HOH to the results of this year's state assessment, and we firmly believe that IB has placed us well along the path to meeting the Common Core standards for our schools. At a time where this district is threatened by the infiltration of charter school initiatives, at least one of which has articulated its focus on raising student performance to meet the Common Core standards, we should not be asking ourselves whether we can afford to keep HOH open. The question really is, how can we possibly afford to close this school? I want to compliment the parents, students, and teachers who are here tonight advocating for our school. Community involvement and advocacy is something that seems to have fallen out of vogue, and it is so encouraging to see our students and parents come out and advocate for something that we all feel so strongly about. These children are our future. Our district and our community owes it to each one of them to provide them with an educational platform to learn, grow, and achieve. IB is that platform. Please don't take that away. Ms. Katrina Goldfinger.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight I would like to talk about my professional and personal experiences at Horizon on the Hudson. I have worked at Horizons for the past 8 years. I have always been proud to represent Horizons, but I am especially proud to be a part of this school at a time when education in our country is facing many challenges. The academic shifts and fiscal reforms that are required for districts to operate directly impact all the stakeholders in our community, but especially our children. As with anything, the adjustments have been painful, the responsibilities and workload increase, and the anxiety levels higher. Through all this, Horizons has been proactive in asking what needs to be done to get our children above and beyond where they need to be. The International Baccalaureate Program is helping us meet these needs. IB gives our staff the tools we need to feel confident in our ability to do well on the APPR. In fact, two of us at the school are now undertaking the professional development needed to become National Board Certified Teachers. We are comfortable with the demands because of the rigors of the IB program. IB gives our students the strategies they need to navigate the rigors of the Common Core while making sure that they are becoming well-rounded citizens. We just returned from a conference with 10,000 educators, and what resonated with us was that Horizons is already 2 years into implementing programs and ideas that other districts and schools around the world are just considering. The theme was the whole child. IB addresses the five tenets of the whole child approach to education. They are that they are knowledgeable, emotionally and physically healthy, civically engaged, self-sufficient in their learning, and ready for the world. All of this is accomplished through the attitudes, concepts, and interdisciplinary skills taught. Each child is encouraged to learn in their own way. These skills help all of us, our children, be successful. The students are constantly reflecting on their actions and making decisions about how they can learn more, do more, and be more. They learn about communities all over the globe, but more importantly, they learn about their own community. And the one thing they know without being taught is that communities have a school at the center of them. And they are right. Communities should have a school in them. It's not enough to have the buildings there. We understand that the building would still be used, but this is not a school. A school serves as symbols of community autonomy, community vitality, community integration, personal control, personal and community tradition, and personal and community identity. The capacity to maintain a school is a continuing indicator of a community's well-being. Philip Langen wrote in 2000, "Of all civic institutions in a community, the school serves the broadest constituency." Not only do schools meet the educational needs of a community and may be a source of employment for its residents, The local school also provides social, cultural, and recreational opportunities. Please don't take this away from our children. They need this school and the unique programs that are offered there. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lemke McMillan?
Here's a list of a few things we do that we really want to share. We think learning like this should happen everywhere. Meet how we learned Mandarin in our school.
On our homeroom stars, we also learn Spanish in school. We meet real authors and books and get information from them to keep writing. We meet the librarian from the public library and learn how we can use that library. Participate in video conference with children around the world, the country, and even national.
We share what we've learned from around the world by doing things like performing Kanishibai Japanese storytelling at the public library in Head Start.
Many other children in this town don't volunteer, but we are global citizens and we care for every boy and girl. We learn about the world, places, things, every single day. Now we feel like the continents are only a step away.
Closing HOH means no school in our third town. That would leave emptiness and we will all be down. All day, every day, everyone is saying, wow, what about our families? Don't turn your back on us now.
We take what we learn and we try to learn more. We explore the real world that opens all doors.
We're learning, we're growing, we're constantly changing. The school is no joke, we're not only playing.
Thank you very much, young lady and young man. Ms. Shania Glasper? That was Shania. Maya Rodriguez.
Good evening. My name is Shania Rodriguez, and I'm here tonight to represent our school, Horizons on the Hudson. Our school is not only a great school for its excellence in teaching, but also for working hard to help us achieve our goals. When we need help, the teachers and staff help us the best way they can. I myself, as well as many other students, have experienced a school closing. That school was West Street School. Now it's an adult learning center, and it does not matter what school. School closing affects students and people who dedicate their life to teaching. This school has never let us down, so why should you? We have all come very far, and we can't give up now. Many of us count on this school for our education. We are all connected in some ways, and to shut down this school would be a tragic for all involved. So we ask you to please reconsider closing our school. We love you. Thank you for your time. Good night.
Thank you. Elia and Tamaya Feddersen? Tamia, please feel free to correct me. Was it Talia and Tamia? Yes, Tamia and Talia Feddersen.
Hi, my name is Talia Featherston, and I am a student who attended HOH in the grades 4th through 5th. I am here today to speak about HOH and say how great it is. All the faculty members have been great to each other, but also great to the students. The teachers have been working very hard to prepare the students for middle school, high school, and college. HOH teachers say that you can do anything if you put your mind to it. I learned a saying there, you are not an American, you are an American. All my teachers from the 4th grade to the 5th grade believed in me and how I believed in myself. I won't forget the library teacher. She taught me to be a great reader by working with the Kamishibai storytelling troupe. We all started reading to each other, then as we became better, we started going to Head Start reading to the children. They all loved it. It was a great experience because our story was told on the internet and we ended up in the newspaper here in Newburgh. All the teachers made education fun instead of boring. If it were not for all the HOH teachers, I would not be an honor roll student in South Middle School. In the fifth grade, we all started something. It was IB Exhibition. It was amazing learning different things. My teacher for exhibition was always there if anyone needed help or had any other difficulties. Please don't disappoint the teachers who work diligently to promote a safe and creative place for learning. Parents place the future of their children in the hands of these caring HOH teachers, but especially don't forget the children who need a safe learning environment. I had a home there, and now they will too.
To schoolwork. O is for outstanding if you push yourself to the limit. R is for report cards. Yikes, yes, I did well. I for intense concentration till I get a good note home. Z is for zing, zing, zing. I'm not done with my test. O is for oh no, horizons might close. N is for no, it won't because there are supporters. S is for supporters are lifesavers.
Miss Jinjel Jackson. Miss Kristen Grau.
Good evening. My name is Chris Grau. My husband and I have two children in Horizon. I just want to take a minute to present to the board some signatures of petitions that we had signed in the community. There are parents, business owners, obviously, a lot of community members. We stood outside the school and Scherzer tushies off getting these signatures. So we hope that they'll help a little bit just to let you know how many people care. We have 21 letters of support from community members and business owners. A couple of names we'd like to mention specifically, if that's okay. The Northeast Gateway to Freedom, the Boys and Girls Club, the City of Newburgh Democratic Committee, the NAACP Newburgh Chapter, Newburgh Heights Association, St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital, the Greater Newburgh Partnership, the Newburgh Housing Authority, and the Newburgh Community Land Bank. Just like all the parents here, we will be looking forward to your support and voting on May 21st. These are my two daughters. Did you either of you want to say anything? What would you like to say? That's okay. They wanted to speak from the heart, but now they're a little shy.
Okay.
Thank you very much for your time this evening.
Thank you, Ms. Grau. Yes, give it to Dr. Shanahan and he'll get it to the board clerk. Thank you very much. Mr. Justin Suarez. Ms. Olga Perez.
Because of the Newburgh and Large City School District's recommendation to close Horizons on the Hudson. We attended Horizons on the Hudson for 7 wonderful years, and as former students, this news brought great concern. Horizons has so much to offer, and we had a chance to experience all of it.
While attending Horizons, we were in the Accelerated Program, Morning Sports, the 21st Century Program, Odyssey of the Mind, and also participated in the International Baccalaureate Program.
Academically at Horizons, I always felt ahead of the game. If I ever fell behind in class, my teachers were always eager to help me. Aside from academics, Horizons couldn't have been built in a better location. I say this because I remember countless trips to the waterfront, Crawford House, and the Washington headquarters. All of these educational attractions were walking distance. I used to attend Gardentown Elementary and never had the opportunity to explore all these historical sites so nearby. At Horizons, I was in awe when I was able to have a conversation with real employees and astronauts from NASA.
At Horizons, I attended many programs that enriched my mind. I feel these programs were important because at my ingenuous age, I absorbed all of the new talents presented to me at Horizons. I learned sign language and Chinese at Horizons. At Horizons, there was so much cultural diversity in my classes, which I truly appreciated. Without Horizons, both Krumi and I would have missed out on so many opportunities and experiences that make us avid participants in clubs and sports at school while maintaining an average of 95 and above. To us, Horizons isn't just a school. It's a second home to all of its students. I want all children to have the opportunity to experience all that I experienced at Horizons. Horizons has made us better us.
Please save Horizons.
Thank you, young ladies, and thank you for coming in. Mr. Andrew Johnston.
Comments short. Anything written by Gerald Bracey is worth reading. Mr. Bracey once wrote a short book called Raising the Bar, a School Board Primer on Student Achievement. It is a book of advice to school board members. There's a passage from this book which haunts me when school budget season arrives, and this year especially. There's little opportunity for public input and less opportunity for the public to receive accurate and comprehensible information explaining why the district must move drastic changes. Bracey wrote, because more than 70% of households do not have children in public school, the school district needs to communicate its vision and student achievement goals very clearly to taxpayers and to the community as a whole to ensure their support. Without this information, the public's perspective and support can be skewed by the anecdotes and advocacy of others, who themselves may not have the entire picture. By contrast, comprehensive information from the school district is likely to both increase support for school budgets and to improve the chances of attracting the involvement of businesses and others in school activities. I invite the Board of Education to consider whether what Mr. Bracey wrote is true, and if it is, whether there is anything that the Newburgh School District needs to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bracey.
former student of Horizons. Just left last year and now I'm in middle school. When I was at the school, I was provided all the materials I needed so that I could learn my best. By keeping the school open, we are giving the children a fun, very well-educated time for students. When I looked at my class and many other classes, I saw participating students learning a lot. This school also has a lot to offer, such as the Accelerate program, the IB program, Honor Society, announcements, video conferences with other schools, and many other hands-on activities. The Accelerate program allows students to exceed their learning abilities so they can learn more. When I was in the Accelerate program, I was pushed in a good direction. I could learn more at a younger age, therefore helping my education. Many features the school has teach students important lessons. Another great feature of the school is the IB program. This program opens students up to different case scenarios that could possibly happen in real life. It also teaches students different traits and attitudes for them to know and be aware of. For example, the trait open-minded teaches students to expand their minds to different experiences, cultures, and traditions. This school is, in a way, a very ideal location for many reasons. One reason is because of field trips. This school is walking distance to the river, which makes it easier for the school to take educational trips to places like New York City by way of ferry and train. It saves the school money because the school doesn't need to pay for buses. When my class took a trip to the Museum of Natural History last year, we walked to the ferry and took a train. That day, our class took a cheap educational trip to New York City. Keeping this school open means a lot to me because I would like my brother Dylan, who is in second grade, to have the same opportunities I had in elementary school. Thank you all for listening, and please keep Horizons open.
Ms. Anaya Thompson? Mr. Ian Proveda.
Ladies and gentlemen of the board, my name is Ian Proveda. I'm here tonight to support in support of my former school, Horizons on the Hudson. All I want more than anything is for HOH to stay open. I attended that school from first grade to fifth grade and made tons of friends and learned a lot too. Think about the employees and the children. Who are that? They attend and work at that school because they enjoy being there. What a shame it will be to lose Horizons. And let me tell you, Horizons is a very important program. The baccalaureate program, also known as IB. The IB program has exactly 10 learner profiles. Inquirer, knowledgeable thinkers, communicators, principled, open-minded, caring, risk-takers, balanced, and reflectors. Inquirers ask a lot of questions, be knowledgeable, be specific. You like to explore concepts, issues, and ideas. Through thinking skills, thinkers make better decisions in life. Communicators like to express themselves and their ideas. When you are principled, you act with integrity and fairness, and know how to differentiate what is right and wrong. Open-minded people are not afraid to share what they think of other things. Caring people are kind and help others. Risk-takers are not afraid to try new things and taking on new challenges. Being balanced means to have a balanced lifestyle, like playing sports and learning at the same time. Lastly, reflective people will reflect on things that they did and see how they can improve. The way I've used these profiles are simple. While at South Middle School, I am caring to others and support the non-bullying program. At school, I also keep an open mind because we will have our differences, but I am also part of this community. I am also an inquirer because I love to learn and ask my teachers questions. At Boy Scouts, I'm knowledgeable. I'm about the survival skills that they teach us.
At restaurants and while I'm eating at home eating, I am a risk taker when I try new food. Every day I try to be critical and reflect on what I have done that day and how I can make it better the next time. So you see, I apply these profiles basically wherever I go. It's helping me become a mature young adult. It's helping everyone from Horizons. Someone from Horizons uses these profiles every day at some point, but they are taught some of these qualities here first. One of my favorite memories at Horizons was being part of the Kamishibai Storytelling Group. At school, I saw a flyer inviting students to join the storytelling group, and I thought it would be fun. Okay. My time may be up, but all I want to say last is that I want to thank Mrs. Dollfinger, Mrs. Mitchell, and Mrs. Jump because they have gone above and beyond the call of learning of teaching.
Our last speaker for the evening will be Ms. Jackie Borgia.
Good evening, I'm Jackie Borgia. I'm a staff member at NFA Main Campus, and I want to piggyback on what others have already said this evening to encourage more creative thinking when considering budget cuts for our district this year, so we can prevent closing schools and loss of vital staff members who provide instructional services to our students. If we are lucky enough to receive additional money from the state this year, we need to be more proactively conservative so that we don't find ourselves in this situation again in the future. I think some areas that should be scrutinized include the following. Central office should consider consolidating departments and take a hard look at the ratio of administration to students at all levels. We have more deputies and associate superintendents than we've ever had, and we're still hiring more. If we could cut just 5 of those positions, we could save almost $1 million. We should also stop approving the lengthy contract extensions that we've been approving. Our needs are continually changing, and we can't get out of those extensions without great expense. Administrative building staffing at all levels is way out of proportion with other districts. Most districts have 550 students to an administrator, but we have approximately 370 students per administrator. Please do not replace the executive principal position at the high school level. We did just fine without that position in the past, and we can continue to do well without one now. I understand that interviews are to begin April 1st, so we have obviously wasted some money advertising and recruiting individuals to interview. Let's not be more wasteful by hiring someone for this position. When departments are relocated around the district, there are always extensive and costly remodelings involved, not to mention the purchase of new furnishings to match the remodeling decor. This is a luxury we can't afford in this district. Stay where they are, and we need to use the furnishings that we have rather than purchasing new. What happens with all the older things? Are we recycling them to buildings in need, selling them, or wastefully disposing of them? We need to consider the demographics of our district and perhaps redraw the line so we can return to more neighborhood school environments, or at the very least look at the feasibility of moving into that model. This would make it less difficult for parents if they need to transport their children for whatever reason, and would decrease our transportation budget tremendously. Our district conference budget should also be looked at and scaled down. The out-of-state and long-distance conference requests should be denied at all levels. We should be looking at ways to provide more in-house staff development, maybe through the teacher center again. The savings, if we did this, would be well worth the effort. Generally, when the district decides to cut the budget, it seems that their focus is on the lower salaried individuals in our district, such as teaching assistant positions. These positions have a direct impact on classes and the classroom of our most vulnerable, our students. Let's be more proactive and protect the backbone of our district, our schools, our students, and our staff that directly impact learning. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Borgia. I'd like to thank everyone for being here with us this evening. I do look forward to seeing all of you when we return from our break, April 4th, Meadow Hill, 6 to 8 p.m. That will be the next budget workshop. At that time, we will have all the information needed to look for a budget for this district to adopt for the 2013-14 school year. We obviously, as you heard here this evening, are looking forward to more money coming back from the state, so that that will help us to hopefully not have to make some of these difficult decisions. I thank you all for being here with us this evening. Be it resolved that the board hereby recesses into executive session for the following purpose: to discuss the employment history of particular individuals. The board may be taking action after the executive session. Can I have a motion? Roll call.
Yes.
Resolution to add the following items to the agenda. Under human resources, we need to add an addendum to resolution E, and then to add additional resolutions N, O, and P.
Can I have a motion to add addendum to item E and add resolutions N, O, and P to the human resources agenda?
So moved.
Second. Roll call.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Redd?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
The addendum to resolution E, which is civil service change of status, is to appoint, change a custodian to a senior custodian position and to appoint a part-time accountant.
Can I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yep.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Resolution N is, be it resolved that the Board of Education authorizes and approves the settlement of the litigation commenced by a certain individual against the Newburgh and Large City School District and others, and approves and ratifies the execution of the settlement agreement and general release dated March the 14th, 2013, as presented to the board at this meeting.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Resolution O, be it resolved that the board's resolution number 120209A, adopted December the 2nd, 2009, is hereby rescinded.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
And resolution P, be it resolved that Joyce Mucci is hereby placed on administrative leave without pay or benefit status, effective her last day of active employment as a building principal and until the time of her resignation, to be effective the close of business on September the 2nd, 2014.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes. Can I have a motion?
You need a resolution to add resolution B under the Assistant Superintendent for Student Intervention and Support Services.
Can I have a motion to add resolution B for the Assistant Superintendent for
Student Intervention and Support Services?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokop?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Kuchek?
Yes.
Resolution B, be it resolved that the Newburgh and Large City School District Board of Education authorizes the board president to enter into a consultant agreement with Allison Wirtz to provide independent evaluations upon parental request for the period of March the 20th, 2013 through June the 30th, 2013, at an amount not to exceed $2,000. A copy of said agreement shall be incorporated by reference within minutes of this meeting. Funding is the general fund.
May I have a motion?
Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr. Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Ms. Gresh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yep.
Ms. Fucek?
Yes.